Hello everyone, today we are going to start a new module, sequential circuit design. In our previous module we have seen the fundamentals of sequential circuit design, where we have seen how fundamental elements of sequential circuits can be designed, for example flip-flops, resistors, and then some simple sequential circuits also we designed, like counters and shift registers. In this module, we are going to extend the whole information, whole knowledge of sequential circuits, and we are going to apply to design bigger applications. We can call them sequential systems also. So we'll look at different applications, for example, pattern matching or some kind of arithmetic operations which can be performed more efficiently if we do sequential, design them using sequential circuits. And also, if given an algorithm, how can we implement that using sequential circuits? So these also we'll see using examples. On top of that, we'll also try to analyze a given sequential circuit. Okay, and the overall methodology would be that these sequential circuits are designed using state machines, and all of them, as we discussed in our previous module also, they are going to be synchronous sequential circuits, means that they will be always synchronized with one clock signal, one global clock signal. So there are two kind of sequential circuits, like they are driven by state machines, either Mealy state machine or Moore state machine. And while understanding how to design these sequential systems, we'll see that these state machines need to be encoded, then these states need to be minimized, and then we'll implement these state machines using gates and flip-flops. So with this objective, let us start with first understanding how a sequential circuit looks like. So to meet this particular smaller objective for this lecture, we'll take an example of a sequential circuit and then try to analyze it. So let's take this sequential circuit as an example, which has two flip-flops. Both of them are D flip-flop, and it takes DA and DB as an input, and this DA takes X as input as well as the output of the other flip-flop B dash. And similarly, this flip-flop takes an input, A as an input, and X, another X as an input. So, Z output is actually the XOR of A and B. So you see, this is a this overall sequential circuit can also be if we try to analyze it, if we try to understand, then how does it work? So we have to first of all think of that what would be the initial state. So let us consider that the initial state or the flip-flops initially were 0 0. So this is how we try to analyze a sequential circuit. We try to assume that the input is 0 0. So if the state, initial state of the flip-flop is 0 0, and then let us consider input is also 0. So because A and B both are 0, my X is 0. So what would happen the next state? Because this X is 0 and B dash is going to be 1. Because B dash is going to be 1, DA is going to be 1. Because this is 1, in the next clock cycle, next edge of the positive edge of the clock cycle, A will become 1. Okay, so this A will become 1. And now, since X is 0 and A is also 0, initial state is 0, so OR of them is going to be 0, DB is going to be 0, so because DB is 0, so B is also going to be 0. The output is going to be 1, 0. Now, let us consider, for example, that the next input is 1. If the next input is 1, the, so based on the first previous state, my output is going to be 0, because A is 0, B is 0, OR of both of is 0. So what we are going to show with this example, you can work out this further on with this input sequence, you will see that my next a and b depends on what is value of x, what was the previous a, what is the previous b. Okay, and then we can find out what would be the next a, next b. Correct. The overall system depends on the input value of a, but input value of x, but this x is essentially modifying the value of a and b in every state. So that way we can write the overall block diagram as like the input is x but the output is z. Okay. Now z does not depend on x directly, because this x is influencing two states which are stored inside, or two flip-flops which are stored, which is A and B. Now these A and B are further not affecting the Z directly, but these A and B are also further being given in a, it depends on the previous state A and B, and then the combinational circuit which drive the next state, and the next state depends on A, B as well as X. So because of this whole of these combinations, now my Z depends on the stored state, it could depend on X also. So that is why we said initially when we were defining a sequential circuit, that means my output does not depend on the current value of X, because it depends on this current value of X would modify the stored state values. And these stored state values would also modify, will depend on, like, the next state would depend on the previous state as well as the value of X. So overall my sequential circuit depends on the previous state values and the current X value. Okay, so in the previous case, based on this diagram, we have written the value of Z, DA and DB. So Z is equal to A zor B, and DA is equal to X zor B dash, DB is equal to X plus X or A. Now we know a D flip flop, DA will become A whenever there is an active edge. Similarly, DB will also become B when there is an active edge. So the translation from DA to A and DB to B is kind of a transparent or straightforward in case of a D flip flop. So let's try to understand that if given such a circuit, how should we go ahead and analyze. So we can break this circuit into a combinational circuit to understand, to analyze. What we can do is, you also see that the value of A and B, because they are the output of my flip-flops, they're not going to change for one clock period. So I can assume that as an input to my calculation of my next state. So basically calculation of my DA or DB. Oh, and this DA and DB will become the next state. So I can say this is DA and DB is going to be A plus, or basically the next state. DA is the A plus value and DB is the B plus value. That means the next state of the flip-flop B. So if we see that, then we can, if we are trying to break this whole circuit into a combinational circuit, then what we can do is, we can analyze and we can say that which all states are possible and what would be their next states. So before going into that explanation, let's also see one more important point which we have also seen in our previous module, but let's reiterate that. So you see that if this is my regular clock, and let's say DA value, because of this combinational logic, will get settled to 0 and sometime it will get settled to 1. Now at the active edge of the clock, this DA value will be transferred to A. Okay, but there would be certain delay, that's because of the flip-flop delay. Now once this A is available, then DA value will further change. You see that once A is available, then it will change the value of DA. So not in this case, but whenever, so here we can assume that this is db. So basically when a is available, x is available, then value of db will further change. Now this whole is a combinational circuit. Now this combinational circuit is taking two inputs. One is original input x, the other is the output of the previous output of the flip-flops. So the whole timing diagram could be understood like this, that this combinational delay, this combinational circuit, the worst case combinational delay could be this. So that means my DA value or the output of this combinational circuit has to get stabilized within certain combinational delay. And that certain combinational delay should be lesser than the setup time plus, this should be lesser than the clock period. Further, this should settle down before the hold time of this clock. So hold time of my register. So before hold time, this gets stable down. And we also have to understand that this combinational delay will start only after the propagation delay of the flip-flop. So all these three things, combinational delay, worst case combinational delay, plus the setup time, plus the hold time, this will determine our clock period. So this point was there to reiterate so that we can understand that whatever combinational circuit we have, how that would affect the clock period and how things would internally manage and would be there would be delays so that they would get finally settled. Okay, now let's look at to get back to the analysis, that given the state these behavioral equations, how do we come up with the understanding of the sequential circuit? So I have rewritten the equations here. Z equal to A XOR B, dA equal to X XOR B dash, and dA equal to X plus A. Now to analyze that, what I can do is I can initialize, I can assume that the A and B values are 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 1, and 1, 0. And then I can create the truth table. So you see that whatever is the A dash is actually dA, and whatever is the B dash is actually dB. So given the X equal to 0, I can calculate that if previous, because X is 0 and my A and B both were 0, so dA is going to be 1. And dB is going to be 0. So 1, 0 is going to be the output. See, if X is 1, then dB would be 1 and dA will become 0. So 0, 1 would be the next state. So similarly, we can compute the next values of truth table from these equations, and we can also compute the value of Z from this A XOR B equation. So this whole table is called a state table, because now my Z depends on what is the value that is stored inside the flip-flop. Inside the flip-flop, A and B is stored, which would be available for one clock period. So now because A and B is stored within the flip-flop, my Z depends on here, because here equation says A is or B. It does not depend on X. But X is modifying the value of A and B by saying that this is the next state. Because of dA and dB, my X is changing the value of dA and dB. So that means it is changing the value of next state for these registers. So that is why A and B, the values which are stored inside the flip-flop, are called state registers. So in other words, what we can say is that my final value of output depends on in which state I am. It does not matter like whether I call this state as S0 or S1, but the important point is if the state is 0, 0, okay, then output is going to be 0. Okay, so this way it is it's more systematic to name all these states as state numbers like S0, S1, S2 and S3. So if I try to map 00 as S0 and 01 as S1, 11 as S2 and 10 as S3, then I can rewrite this table as this table, the new table. This table is actually called a state table. Here we are not defining what would be the meaning, what would be the value of S0. So whether S0 is going to be 00 or 01, but we are here defining that S0 is a state where if x is 0, then next value, next state is going to be S3, and if x is 1, the next state is going to be S1 and output is going to be 0. So this state table essentially describes the behavior of the circuit. So further, I would like to emphasize that it doesn't matter that what would be the encoding, but if these are the state transitions, like if x is 0, then how, which state I'll go to the next state, which state would be the next state. So this way, this state table actually characterized our sequential circuit. So this is one of the important representation of my sequential circuit. You remember that when we were doing a combinational circuit, the combinational circuits were represented by either the expressions, Boolean expressions, or using truth table. Here, sequential circuits are more appropriately described using state table. These state tables are very much like truth tables, but here the encoding of the state is not defined. Okay, so if it is defined, then it is good, but even if it is not defined, then also it makes complete sense. Now this is one of the representation. The other representation of my sequential circuit is called state diagrams. So in the state diagram, we represent our sequential circuits in form of a state diagram. It's a graphical representation. In this graphical representation, each of the state represent one circle. Now here in this particular example, because my output does not depend on input, but it depends on the state. So the state diagram explicitly says that if I am in state 0, then the output is going to be 0. And if I am in state 1, then the output is going to be 1. And if I am in state 2, S2, then the output is 0. Similarly, if I am in state S3, then output is going to be 1. So circles represent states, which state I am in. And if output is associated with that state, then output is also given by writing a dash and then writing the output, corresponding output. Now, the circle represent states, and now there would be edges that also represent transitions. Now if x equal to 1, then S0, the next state is going to be S1. So for S0, the next state is going to be S1. And similarly, if input is 0, then the next state for S0 is going to be S3. So arrows represent the transition of the state from S0 to S3 when the input is X. So these arrows are annotated with the value of input. If input is 0, then S0 would be S0 will move to S3 state, and if input is 1, then S0 will transition to S1 state. Similarly, for S1 also, we can find out that if input is 0, then it will transition to S0 state, and if input is 1, then S1 will transition to S2 state. Now, for S2 state also, we can check both the conditions. If input is 0, then it will transition to S1 state, and if input is 1, then it will transition back to itself. So there is a feedback loop from S2, it will still remain S2. Now for S3, if the input is 1, S3 will transition to S1 state, and If input is 0, then S3 will transition to S2 state. So this particular type of state machines, where output does not depend on the input but it depends on the states, it's called Moore machine or Moore machine. So this is one type of the Moore machine, one type of the state diagram. Let's take another example. So in the other example also we have two flip-flops, but to make things more diverse, we have take JK flip-flop. So in JK flip-flop, there A and B are two outputs, and for A flip-flop, JA and JK, JA and KA is the input, and for B flip-flop, JB and KB is the input, and output depends on both A, B as well as value of X. So you can reimagine this also. There are two flip-flops, A and B, whose output is A and B. Now the input of both the flip-flops, J and K, depends on X as well as the output of the flip-flop. And similarly, the output, final output of the circuit depends on both X as well as A as well as B. Okay, so if we need to analyze this again, we can first, what we can do is we can create a state table. So in the state table, we can enumerate all the possibilities of A and B, and then we can calculate what are the next states. And from the next states, these next state depends on what is the value of X, or what is the value of what is the value, what would be the next state when X is 0, what is the next value, next state when X is 1. So because now we need to find out what is the value of next state, we can find out the value of next state by using the characteristic equation of JK flip-flop. For JK flip-flop, the next state is defined by J Q dash plus K dash Q. So whenever we need to find out the next state, so basically A dash and B dash, then we need to use this particular equation, and using this particular equation, we have to find out the value of next state. So here I am computing directly for you. You can do it as your homework, and maybe we can use I can upload a tutorial where we can work out all these problems, at least one of these problems, so that it can be helpful. But yes, for now let's take this state table as the worked out example. Now we enumerate all the possibilities of A and B, 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 1 and 1, 0, and then we calculate the value of A plus and B plus. So let's solve one of the row. So if JA, depends on X and B, and KA depends on 0. So let's say initially X is 0. So if X is 0, JA and KA both are going to be 0. Similarly, JB and KB both are going to be 0, because JA and KA is 0, so A dash is going to be 0 because it is the previous state. Similarly, because JB and KB both are 0, so next state of B is also going to be remain same. While when X is 1, then JA is 0, KA is 1. Because JA and KA is 1, the next output is going to be 0 for A plus. A plus value is going to be 0. On the other hand, JB is going to be 1 and KB is going to be 0. Because JB is 1, KB is 0, so B plus is going to be 1. Similarly, Z is going to be 0, because because all of these values, this is 0, X is 0 here, and here B is 0. Because of that, if X is 0, my Z is 0. However, if X is 1, then B dash is going to be 1 and x is 1, so output is going to be 1, rest we can ignore. So this is the way we have to calculate the value of A plus and B plus in all the scenarios. If we calculate the value of A plus and B plus in all the scenarios, then we'll get this state table. Now, like the previous example, we can map 0, 0 to S0, 0, 1 to S1, 1, 1 to S2, and 1, 0 to S3. Then we can finally create this as a state table. So you see the difference here in this state table, one of the column represent what are the present state. The next state column depends on the input combinations. If input combination is x equal to 0, then the next state is going to be different. If input combination equal to 1, then the next state is going to be different. Similarly, here z depend on value of x. So there would be, if x is equal to 0, then there would be these values of z, and if x equal to 1, then these would be the values of z. So this is how we write the state diagram. Now using the state diagram, we can again further create the state table. Using the state table, we can create the state diagram. So here we have again four states. So now output does not depend on the state. So in the circle of the state, each state, we are going to write only the state number S0, S1, S2, and S3. Okay, for each transition this time, now S0, if the input is 0, then output is 0. So here we have to represent the output along with the edges. So each transition would mean that what is the input and what would be the output. So numerator says the input and denominator says the output. So if the input is 0, output is going to be 0 in case of S0. Now if input is 1, then S0 will get transitioned to S1 and output is also going to be 1. Similarly, for S1, if the input is 0, then output is going to be 1, and if input is 1, then output is going to be 0 and state will transition from S1 to S2. Okay, so similarly from S2, if input is 0, then it will still remain S2. If input is 1, then S2 will be transitioned to S0 and the output is going to be 1. Okay, so this denominator represents the output. Similarly for S3, if S3 input x is 0, then it will still remain x3 and the output is 0. If input is 1, then S3 would be transitioned to S1 and the output is going to be 1. So since here my output depends on not only the current state, but it also depends on what is the current input. So this particular type of machine is called a Millet state machine. In the Millet state machine, my output Z depends on what is the internal state, what is the current input. Okay, so now we can summarize this whole sequential circuits into this diagram, where we are saying that actually there is going to be the input and some combinational circuit. This combinational circuit would define what would be the next state. So the state registers would be the array of flip-flop, and whenever the clock period is there, whenever the active edge of the clock would be there, so this calculation would affect the next state, and next state is also given as the input. So essentially, to the combinational circuit, there are two inputs. One is the current input, plus one is the present state. So this present state is also going to compute the next state values. And the output, if my output depends only on the state registers, then we call it Moore state machine or Moore state machine. If my output depends on input and the present state. You see here, this combinational circuit also have one of the input is the original input, and also the state the state register's output is also considered as input. So when output depends on input, present input plus the present state, then this is called Mealy state machine. So with this, I would like to summarize this lecture and will close. So what we have understood that in the state machines or in a sequential circuit, the previous state information is captured inside the flip-flop. And many a times the state information would be invisible to the end user or to the final output, because this state registers as well as the state information is invisible. So output, it appears that it depend on not only the current input but all the past inputs. And fortunately, all the previous inputs, it could be infinite, but we can summarize all the previous infinite input into number of finite states. And because all the infinite inputs can be summarized in form of finite state, that is why it is also called finite state machines. Okay, so these finite states or these states would be usually invisible to the user. That is why, because they're not visible, that is why many a times this encoding is also not visible, whether S0 would be encoded as 00 or 01, although it depends on the it impacts the implementation, it impacts the combinational circuit which we are designing inside the state machine implementation. But to the end user, many a times it does not matter whether you are defining S0 or S1 different states as what encoding. Okay, so the other thing we have learned is the output may not depend on the current input. Of course, it would depend on the past input, but it may not depend on the current input. If it depends on the current input, we call it a Mealy state machine. If it doesn't depend on the current input but only on the past input, then we are calling it Moore state machine. So with this, I would close, and we'll see you in the next lecture. Thank you.